Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 9th of October 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Trivandrum edition. The print version for Hyderabad edition is not available today. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. This news article says that the Government of India unveils faceless IT assessment and it opens National E-Assessment Center. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, this news article mentions two important keywords. One is the E-Assessment Scheme and the second one is the National E-Assessment Center. First, we shall be seeing the details of the scheme. Then we shall see how the scheme will be implemented by setting up of national and regional centers. And finally, we shall be seeing the kind of advantages or benefits which will be there because of digital system of assessment. See, one of the key highlights of Union Budget 2019-20 was that the government proposed to launch a faceless e-assessment with no human interface. And based on this, the central government recently notified e-assessment scheme on 2nd of September 2019. So this scheme aims to facilitate the faceless assessment of income tax returns. And the scheme also completely aims to have an electronic communication between the tax officials and the taxpayers. And note that this e-assessment scheme is implemented by the Ministry of Finance. So what is faceless e-assessment? It means that there is no human interface between the taxpayers and IT department. The taxpayers will receive notices on their registered emails. Then they will also receive real-time alerts by the way of SMS on their registered mobile numbers, etc. So this new initiative of faceless assessment is expected to increase the ease of compliance for taxpayers as the cost and the anxiety of taxpayers are likely to be greatly reduced. See, this e-assessment scheme is based mainly on four pillars. One is that there will be no human interface. Next is that it will have a dynamic jurisdiction. And third, it is based on a team-based working. And finally, the functional specialization. So the first pillar is no human interface, which means there will be a faceless assessment procedure which shall be adopted. The second pillar is the dynamic jurisdiction. This dynamic jurisdiction aims at the entire process of tax assessment in real time, and all the assessment cases are allocated to the tax assessing office on real time. The third pillar is the team-based working, that is, working together in a team will promote the team spirit and the coordination among the tax assessing employees. We'll see how. And the final pillar is the functional specialization. That is, the entire process will be streamlined based on different functions like assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, and so on. And each unit is manned with officers of respective expertise or specialization. So there will be functional specialization for every unit. Now, let us see how this scheme is going to be implemented. This scheme will be implemented with a network of regional e-assessment centers across India, and also there will be one nodal center, that is the National E-Assessment Center, which will be located at New Delhi. And this National E-Assessment Center will be headed by the Principal Chief Commissioner of Income Tax. And there will be 8 regional e-assessment centers at different regions of India. One will be located in Delhi, the other at Mumbai, the other at Chennai, the other one at Kolkata, and other regional e-assessment centers at Ahmedabad, Pune, Bengaluru, and Hyderabad. And all these regional centers, that is, each of these regional centers will be headed by Chief Commissioner of Income Tax. In addition to this, all the offices of the National E-Assessment Center and the regional e-assessment centers will have dynamic and all India jurisdiction. So this kind of connective and collaborative effort of the offices from different centers is likely to lead towards better quality of assessments because it will be a pan-India organizational structure. So it is expected that it would impart greater efficiency and also transparency and accountability in the assessment process, because now e-governance comes into place. So it is more likely that there will be greater transparency and accountability in the assessment process. And as we saw earlier, this system will ease the compliance of the taxpayers, and it will also improve the quality of the assessment process, and the case disposals will also be fast. So overall, we can tell that it is expected to promote the ease of doing business in the country. So this is all about this news article. In this news article, we have seen about the National E-Assessment Center, then the regional E-Assessment Centers, then about the E-Assessment Scheme, and the likely advantages or benefits which will be there because of the digital system of assessment and how it will promote governance. With this information, test your understanding of the topic with the help of the practice question. We shall discuss the practice question at the end of the session. This discussion is based on an editorial. This editorial gives insights about the agricultural farming methods and the criticism based on those various agricultural farming methods. Also, keep in mind that the editorial is written by two authors, and one of the author is a chair professor of NABARD, which is the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. So this editorial is based on the author's scientific knowledge and his expertise on the field. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this editorial is given here for your reference. In this editorial, the authors discuss about some modern agricultural practices. Let us first see about them in brief before moving on to the editorial. First is about the Green Revolution in the 20th century. The term Green Revolution is applied to the successful agricultural experiments in many developing countries. And India is also one of the countries where it was the most successful. See, the Green Revolution resulted in a record grain output, which was 131 million tons during the period 1978-79. So this established India as one of the world's biggest agricultural producers. But Green Revolution technologies were criticized because of their increased use of chemicals in agriculture. So those who opposed this method proposed that alternative to using chemicals, that is, a non-chemical agriculture is also possible. So at this time only, the term organic farming became very famous. According to the authors, the term organic farming represented a variety of non-chemical oriented methods of farming and less chemical oriented methods of farming. There is a difference, non-chemical and less chemical. Non-chemical means completely no chemical, and less chemical means less quantity or amount of chemicals. Then the authors mention about another method, which is Rudolf Steiner's biodynamics. See, biological dynamic agriculture is also called as biodynamics. It is a system of agricultural management which is based on a series of lectures given by Rudolf Steiner in the year 1924. The intention of a series of agricultural lectures were to instruct farmers how to influence the organic life on earth through cosmic and terrestrial forces. Now, this is important because biodynamic agriculture consisted primarily of concocting or combining and utilizing 8 biodynamic preparations. So these 8 biodynamic preparations would stimulate vitalizing and harmonizing process in the soil. So just know about this method. Then the authors talk about the methods that are used in India. One is homeo farming. See, in a chemical agriculture, some substance is used to restore the material imbalance. It is done by administering the substance in physical doses. But in homeopathy, it is a mode of action using small but more potent substance. Usually this substance is a diluted substance, and this substance would have lost its toxicity, and simultaneously it had acquired a stronger medicinal property. So this substance stimulates the soils and its organisms' intrinsic defensive mechanism, and it also re-establishes the balance of vital forces within it, which is capable of fighting the disorder so that the health of the soil will be restored. So this homeo farming stimulates the already existing potential of soil rather than application of an external substance. So this is what homeo farming does. Next, there is a mention about Vedic farming or Vedic organic agriculture. See, this is a natural agriculture which is free from all poisonous fertilizers, pesticides and herbicides. And it is the agriculture that is grown by the farmers by using Vedic literature. Next, native eco-farming has been mentioned. This farming is based on the principle of no tilling and also based on the principle of complete recycling and management of farm waste. Next, Agnihotra farming has been mentioned. Agnihotra means a healing fire, which is from the ancient science of Ayurveda. It is a process of purifying the atmosphere through a specially prepared fire. This is usually performed at sunrise and sunset every day. So this Agnihotra utilizes the combined effect of various factors, such as burning of specific organic substances like the cow's ghee, rice grains, twigs of plants, etc. And according to this practice, the burning of the organic substances injects the atmosphere with nutrients. The proponents or the followers of this method say that modern science of agriculture stresses only about the soil quality and the water quality, but there is no say about the atmosphere. But according to the ancient science of Agnihotra or the Homa therapy, atmosphere is the biggest factor in producing healthy and nutritious plant growth. So atmosphere is also considered in Agnihotra. And according to the practitioners of this method, if you make the atmosphere more nutritious and fragrant by performing Homa, then a type of protective coating is laid on plants. So any diseases, fungi, pests, etc. do not thrive or they do not live on the plants. The next type of method that has been mentioned is Amrutpani farming. Here Amrut means the heavenly drink. According to mythology, it refreshes the gods and it has the power to resurrect the dead. That is, bring back the dead to life. In the same manner, Amrutpani is also compared. Here Amrutpani invigorates the living soil. That is, it gives strength to the living soil and it converts a dead soil into a living one. And this Amrutpani is a liquid manure which is prepared by a technique known as Ahimsak Rishikrishi Deshpande technique. Like Panchakavya, Amrutpani is also used to improve the soil fertility. Now, in this context comes the recent farming technique, which is the zero budget natural farming, or in short ZBNF. And this method was popularized by an Indian agriculturist named as Subhash Palekar. The authors of this editorial state that this zero budget natural farming is against both inorganic farming and organic farming. It is because the authors say that according to Mr. Palekar, all knowledge that has been created by the agricultural universities are false. They are saying this because according to Mr. Palekar, organic farming is more dangerous than chemical farming and it is worse than an atom bomb. So what is this zero budget natural farming or ZBNF? It is a set of farming methods. It is also a grassroots or most basic peasant movement that was carried out by Mr. Subhash Palekar, and this has spread to various states in India. Especially it has attained wide success in southern India, in the state of Karnataka, where it first evolved. See, the neoliberalization of the Indian economy, that is the ideology of free market competition, has led to a deep agrarian crisis. And this crisis is making small-scale farming a non-feasible occupation. This is because the privatized seeds, then the agricultural inputs and the markets are all inaccessible and quite expensive, that is quite costly for the farmers. So they have to spend more on their inputs, but they get only less on their outputs. So the Indian farmers are increasingly finding themselves in a vicious cycle of debt. Under such conditions, the zero budget farming promises to end the reliance of farmers on loans and it promises to drastically cut the production costs by ending the debt cycle for the farmers. So this method is a form of low external input sustainable agriculture, or in short LEISA. It is because all the inputs are to be locally resourced from in and around the village, or it can be resourced even within the farm in a symbiotic way. The word budget in the zero budget farming refers to credit and also the expenses. Thus the phrase zero budget means without using any credit and without spending any money on purchased inputs. And natural farming means farming with nature and without the use of chemicals. So this is all about zero budget natural farming. Know that there are four pillars of this zero budget natural farming. One pillar is Jivamrita or Jivamrutam. It is a fermented microbial culture. It enhances the soil microbiome through the application of cow dung, cow urine and other local ingredients. So the growth of the microorganisms in the soil will be enriched because it provides nutrients, and most importantly, it also acts as a catalytic agent that promotes the activity of the microorganisms. Also, it increases the earthworm activity as well. And Jeevamruta also helps to prevent fungal and bacterial plant diseases. The next pillar is Bijamruta or Bijamrutam. It is a treatment that is used for seeds, seedlings or any planting material. Bijamruta is effective in protecting the young roots from fungus as well as from soil-borne and seed-borne diseases. These diseases commonly affect the plants after the monsoon period, if you see. This Bijamruta is composed of similar ingredients like Jeevamruta, such as the local cow dung, which is a powerful natural fungicide. And it also contains cow urine, which is a strong antibacterial liquid. Then it also contains lime and soil. The next pillar is Achchadana or mulching. Here, mulching refers to the process where the materials such as decaying leaves, barks or compost are spread around a plant or the materials are spread over a plant. This is basically done to enrich the soil or to insulate the soil. The final pillar is Vapsa or the moisture. The plant roots need a lot of water, and Vapsa is a condition where there are both air molecules and water molecules which are made present in the soil. So it is the building up of soil humus in order to increase the soil aeration. So these are the four pillars. In addition to these four pillars, the zero budget natural farming also includes three methods of insect and pest management. They are Agniastra, Brahmastra and Neemastra. They depend on the nature and type of the insect or the pest attack. For different attacks, different formulations from locally available resources are prepared. All the different preparations use cow urine, cow dung, tobacco, fruits, green chili, garlic and neem. So this preparation works as a biopesticide. So according to the proponents of this method, if all these preparations can be achieved, then there will not be any need to use a chemical fertilizer. So this is all about the zero budget natural farming. But the authors of this editorial have some criticism over this method. They call this method as unsubstantiated claims. So why are they calling this method and its achievements as unsubstantiated claims? Let us see now. For this, the authors of this editorial have given some reasons. They have given five reasons. The first reason is that according to the authors, the zero budget natural farming is a hardly zero budget, which means it is not that much zero budget. It is because many ingredients in this method and its formulations have to be purchased. Apart from this, the method also includes other costs according to the authors, like the wages of hired labor, then the imputed value of the family labor, which means the cost representing the value of the family labor. The next cost is imputed or estimated rent over the owned land, then the cost of maintaining cows, and finally the cost on electricity and pump sets. The authors are criticizing that these costs are conveniently ignored by the zero budget natural farming proponents. Secondly, there are no independent studies to validate the claims of this method. There are no studies that the zero budget natural farming plots have a higher yield than the non-zero budget natural farming plots. Independent studies based on field trials are also not available for this method. Currently, if you see, one field trial is going on at the G.B. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology, which is situated at Uttarakhand. But according to the authors, the full results of this field trial will be available only after 5 years. Moreover, based on sources, the authors are noting that the preliminary observations of this field trials have recorded a shortfall in the yield. That is, there is less yield. The observations state that there is about 30% shortfall of yield in the zero budget natural farming plots when compared with non-zero budget natural farming plots. So this is the second reason, that there are no independent studies to validate the claims of this zero budget natural farming method. Now the third reason is that most of the claims in this method stand agricultural science on its head. It means that the claims are opposite to the agricultural science. This is because according to the author's expertise, Indian soils are poor in organic matter content, such as about 59% of soils are low in available nitrogen and about 49% of soils are low in available phosphorus, and about 48% of soils are low or medium in available potassium. Because nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium are the basic micronutrients that is required for the fertility of the soil. In addition to this, the Indian soils are also deficient in certain other micronutrients like zinc, iron, manganese, copper, molybdenum and boron, which is required for the fertility of the soil. So, the micronutrient deficiencies lead to decline in the fertility of the soil. And also in some regions, the soils are saline, that is they are quite salty, and in some regions soils are acidic. This may be due to the nutrient deficiencies or due to the toxicity that has been caused by aluminium, manganese and iron in the soil. And in certain other regions, soils are toxic due to heavy metal pollution from the industrial and the municipal waste or due to excessive application of fertilizers and pesticides. So, based on the soil nature, the agricultural scientists recommend location-specific solutions to nurture the soil health and to sustain soil fertility. So, agricultural sciences very much required, but the zero-budget natural farming is opposite to agricultural science. Because this zero-budget natural farming method insists on one blanket solution. This means the method suggests a general solution for all the problems of Indian soils. But as we just saw, soil in different locations is of different nature. So, the authors are saying that this one solution may not help to yield the productivity as this method claims. Now, let us see the fourth reason. The fourth reason is about the nutritional requirement of plants. The authors are blaming Mr. Palekar that he has a totally irrational position on the nutrient requirements of plants. According to Mr. Palekar, 98.5% of the nutrients that plants need is obtained from air, water and sunlight, and only the remaining 1.5% is from the soil. And also all the nutrients are present in adequate quantities in all types of soils, but they are not in usable form. So, the formulation of Jivamrit makes these nutrients available to the plants by increasing the population of soil microorganisms. So, this is a claim made by Mr. Palekar. But according to the authors, all these are baseless claims. It is because the Jivamrit gives just about 750 grams of nitrogen per acre per season. But this is totally inadequate because the nitrogen requirements of Indian soils are more. So, we can see that there is a mismatch in the claims of nutritional requirement of plants made by Mr. Palekar and made by the scientists. Now, the final reason is the spiritual nature of agriculture that is proposed by this method by Mr. Palekar. It is because he has claimed that because of this zero-budget natural farming's spiritual closeness to nature, its practitioners will stop drinking, gambling, lying, eating non-vegetarian food, and they will also stop wasting the resources. So, the authors are also criticizing these claimed spiritual nature of this method. So, these are some of the reasons why the authors are calling this zero-budget natural farming method and its achievements as unsubstantiated claims. Hence, as a conclusion, the authors are proposing for a more scientific approach towards agriculture. The scientific approach should include the methods to improve the soil health. Then it should also contain steps to check the wind and water erosion of soils. Then it should also involve innovative technologies which will help to minimize physical degradation of soils due to waterlogging, flooding and crusting. Here the term soil crusting refers to the forming processes and the consequences of a thin layer at the soil surface. And this thin layer causes reduced porosity and high penetration resistance in the soil. So, this is considered as degradation of soil. So, the scientific method, ultimately the scientific method should provide location-specific interventions towards balanced fertilization and integrated nutrient management of the land and soil, as against what the zero-budget natural farming proposes. Hence, according to the authors, the inclusion of zero-budget natural farming method in our agricultural policy is not a wise decision. It is because the zero-budget natural farming method does not include any scientific approach. So, in this editorial, we have seen different kinds of agriculture in brief. Now, you can use them in any of your mains answers, and we have also seen why this zero budget natural farming will not work for a country like India, which has varied soil pattern and soil nutrition requirements. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is regarding the recently released Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, the Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey was conducted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and United Nations Children's Fund, that is UNICEF, between 2016 and 2018. And the news article is telling that it is the first ever national nutrition survey that is conducted by the government. See, this Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey is a cross-sectional household survey covering more than 120,000 children and adolescents between the age group of 0 to 19 years. From both the urban and the rural areas across all the states of India, also Delhi. This survey aims to measure malnutrition, which also includes worm infestation and micronutrient deficiencies. So how they will measure is by collecting biochemical samples like blood samples, urine samples, etc. Then this survey also measures the anthropometric data like weight for age, then height for age, then weight for height, etc. The survey also focuses on details of non-communicable diseases like diabetes, hypertension, cholesterol, and kidney function in children and adolescents, and also the prevalence of obesity or overweight, then also data on muscular strength and fitness. And know that Clinical Development Services Agency is the national monitoring agency to monitor the biological samples like blood, urine and stool samples. And this agency was created under Department of Biotechnology, which comes under the Ministry of Science and Technology. The main aim for creating this agency is to facilitate the development of affordable healthcare products for the public health diseases. Now let us see the important facts that have been revealed by this Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey. The first point is regarding the rate of breastfeeding. So in this table, we'll be seeing certain set of parameters that has been mentioned in the news article for the urban population and for the rural population sample. So first is the rate of breastfeeding, as we told. Here the target group is the children between 12 and 15 months in both urban areas and rural areas. This survey tells that overall 83% of the children between the age group of 12 and 15 months are breastfed. In urban area, it is 76% and in rural areas, it is 85%. One thing which we can tell from this data is that the rate of breastfeeding is inversely proportional to the wealth of the households. Because if you see, the urban households are comparatively wealthier. So one could have expected that the breastfeeding percentage or breastfeeding rates have been higher for the urban households. But in fact, it is higher in the case of rural households. One reason can be there are more number of working mothers in the urban areas. So the breastfeeding is improper because they have to travel long distances to reach their workplace. So they cannot breastfeed their baby in a timely manner. And also most of the workplaces does not have facility to take care of the infants. So the urban mothers lack time and also the facility to breastfeed their children. Another reason that is given is the prosperity of the urban household, because usually the urban mothers are going for diversified or supplementary food for their children apart from the mother's milk. So this is the reason why the rate of breastfeeding is lower in the urban households. The next parameter is children receiving frequent meals. The survey tells that 44% of children from the rural areas receive meals more frequently when compared to 37% of children in the urban areas. So we can see that the rural children are receiving frequent meals. Next is the diversified diet. The survey tells that 26.9% of children in the urban areas are fed an adequately diversified diet. But in case of rural areas, it is only 19% of children who receive diversified diet. The next parameter is the iron deficiency in both children and adolescents. The survey tells that 40.6% of children and adolescents who are living in the urban areas suffer from iron deficiency, but the iron deficiency prevalence is lower in the rural areas, which is 29%. This news article is telling that the iron deficiency is lower because of certain health programs of the government, like the National Iron Plus Initiative to combat iron deficiency. Then also Anemia Mukt Bharat to reduce the prevalence of anemia by 3% points every year. And also because of programs like Poshan Abhiyan, which is the National Nutrition Mission, which we'll be seeing later. Then this survey has also measured the overweight and obesity by measuring the subscapular skin fold thickness, in short SSFT, based on different age groups. Basically, this technique helps to measure the body fat, that is the amount of fat present in a human body. And this survey found that for the children who are in the age group of 5 to 9 years, 14.5% of the children belonging to urban areas had higher subscapular skin fold thickness, whereas in case of rural areas, it was lower, which is 5.3%. And for the adolescents belonging to the age group of 10 to 19 years, those adolescents in the urban areas had higher subscapular skin fold thickness, which was 10.4%, whereas in rural areas, the adolescents had lower SSFT, which is 4.3%. The next parameter is vitamin D deficiency. The survey reveals that 19% of the children in urban areas were suffering from vitamin D deficiency when compared to 12% of the children in the rural areas. So you can see that vitamin D deficiency is higher in the cities. This is despite the fact that higher percentage of children in cities consume dairy products when compared to those children who are in the rural areas. The survey tells that 74% of urban children consume dairy products when compared to 58% of children in the rural areas. So we can see that the children from the urban population consume more dairy products. Even though they consume more dairy products, still they are deficient in vitamin D. Now, one reason could be the wealthier household and the lifestyle, like consuming more foods that are rich in fat. And also, the children from the urban households lead a sedentary lifestyle. That is, they involve very little or no physical activity. So, huge calorie intake and less or no physical activity is leading to vitamin D deficiency. The next parameter is the zinc deficiency. This survey tells that 20% of the rural children who belong to the age group of 1 to 4 years suffer from zinc deficiency when compared to 16% of children belonging to the same age group in the urban area. So you can see that zinc deficiency is higher in the rural areas. Know that lack of intake of zinc can cause diarrhea, growth retardation, then loss of appetite, and also impact immune function. Then this survey also mentions about stunting, which is nothing but low height for age. The survey reveals that 37% of children in the rural area have stunting issues when compared to 27% of children in the urban areas. The next parameter is the underweight, that is low weight for age. This survey tells that 36% of children from the rural areas suffer from underweight when compared to 26% of children from the urban areas. So we can see that children from the rural areas suffer from more of stunting and underweight when compared to the children from the urban areas. But if you remember, we saw that the rate of breastfeeding was more in case of rural children, and also children received more frequent meals, especially in the rural areas. But stunting and underweight is more for the children in the rural areas. One reason is because their diet is not diversified. We saw that diversified diet was high in case of urban areas when compared to rural areas. And another reason can be severe acute malnutrition, which is the most extreme and visible form of nutrition. Usually this severe acute malnutrition happens when the body does not get enough nutrients due to a poor diet or a lack of food. So having food is one thing, but we should have diversified diet. And there are also certain people in the rural areas who do not have a proper food at all. So both these can lead to stunting and underweight in children. This news article tells that considering all these facts, Niti Aayog is currently developing a strategy to deal with the problems that are unique to children who are living in the cities. And it also aims to address the factors that hampered the implementation of the government schemes. So the government has realized the need to give special focus to children who are living in urban areas under its Poshan Abhiyan scheme. Know that Poshan Abhiyan is also called as National Nutrition Mission. It was launched in the year 2018 to improve the nutritional status of children up to 6 years, and also to improve the nutritional status of adolescent girls, pregnant women and lactating mothers in order to achieve specific targets for reduction in certain parameters like low birth weight babies, then stunting growth, then undernutrition, and also the prevalence of anemia. So from this news article analysis, we can say that malnutrition in India is characterized by relatively poor levels of breastfeeding and higher prevalence of micronutrient deficiencies like iron deficiency, zinc deficiency, and also vitamin D deficiency, as well as also due to obesity. So we can see that India has both cases of obesity and undernutrition. This means that while some children get more than required to eat, whereas others suffer from a poor diet. And the survey also shows that the health problems for children across India is not unique. That is, it is not the same. There is always a rural-urban divide. So this is all about this news article. There is one more news article along with this big news article, which is titled Children Face Rising Risk of Diabetes, High Cholesterol. This news article is also in continuation with the survey that we discussed, which is the Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey. It tells that according to this survey, Indian children are facing the double burden of malnutrition and also the rising risk of non-communicable diseases. Now, non-communicable diseases are diseases such as diabetes, high cholesterol, chronic kidney disease, and hypertension. We already discussed the survey results with regards to undernutrition and overweight, and also with regards to obesity among the Indian children from 0 to 19 years in detail. This report tells that the prevalence of abdominal obesity among children and adolescents increased with the level of mother's schooling and household wealth. This might be because of the increase in income, which led towards greater spending. So they spend more on fatty foods and soft drinks. And when children consume more fatty foods and soft drinks, and also when they lack physical activity, it will ultimately result in obesity. Now, you should know that abdominal obesity occurs when excessive fat around the stomach and abdomen has built up to the extent that it is likely to have a negative impact on health. This survey results say that the highest percentage of children with abdominal obesity are observed in states such as Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, and Goa, while the lowest percentage was recorded in states was observed in the state of Bihar. And in case of adolescents, the highest percentage of abdominal obesity was observed in Delhi and Tamil Nadu, and the lowest percentage was observed in Assam. And according to this survey, the rural-urban divide exists in case of abdominal obesity as well. A higher prevalence was observed among children and adolescents who are residing in the urban areas when compared to those children and adolescents from the rural areas in terms of abdominal obesity. The largest prevalence was seen in states such as Goa and Delhi, and the lowest prevalence of such a condition was seen in states such as Madhya Pradesh and Jharkhand. So this news article speaks about the survey results of the Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey on abdominal obesity. To sum up, from both these news articles, we have seen the results of Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey and also about the survey and about Clinical Development Services Agency. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article speaks about the Hindu Kush Himalayan region. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. This news article tells that India Meteorological Department will collaborate with the respective meteorological agencies in the countries of China and Pakistan for better data gathering in the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, so that it will help to understand the impact of climate change in this region and also provide climate forecast services to the countries that are present in the region. So now let us discuss about this Hindu Kush Himalayan region. According to India Meteorological Department, the Hindu Kush Himalayan region comprises of both the Hindu Kush Mountains and the Himalayan Mountains. It spans the countries of Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, India, Myanmar, Nepal, Pakistan, Kyrgyzstan, Mongolia, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan. So these are the 12 countries which form the part of Hindu Kush Himalayan region as per India Meteorological Department. But know that according to International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, the Hindu Kush Himalayan region covers across 8 countries, which are Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, India, Myanmar, Nepal, and Pakistan. And also according to one of the national institutes under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, which is G.B. Pant National Institute of Himalayan Environment and Sustainable Development, this Hindu Kush Himalayan region consists of these 8 countries only. So only in this IMD report you can see the extra 4 countries, which are the countries of Kyrgyzstan, Mongolia, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan. So what is the significance of this region, or the importance of this region? This region is one of the greatest mountain systems of the world. It is home to some of the world's highest peaks, and unique cultures are present in this region. Also, you can see numerous numbers of flora and fauna, that is plants and animal species, in this Hindu Kush Himalayan region. And also it has got a vast reserve of natural resources. Also know that it is the source of 10 major rivers, which are the rivers Amudarya, Indus, Ganges, Brahmaputra, Airavati, Salween, Mekong, Yangtze, Yellow River and Tarim. And this region also provides ecosystem services. When we tell ecosystem services, it means the benefits that the humans or the human population that reside in this area receive from the environment, like water, food and energy from the environment. According to International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, this Hindu Kush Himalayan region benefits almost 1.9 billion people who depend on this region for water, food and energy. And this region also represents the largest area of permanent ice cover and freshwater reserve, apart from the two poles of the earth, which are the north and the south poles. So this region is also called as the third pole, because it contains the largest area of permanent ice cover and also freshwater reserves. And this region is also called as cryospheric zone. Cryosphere means the frozen water part of the earth, such as ice, snow cover, lake ice, glaciers, ice sheets, etc. And this cryospheric zone, that is the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, is susceptible to climate change. Until now, there is no proper climate analysis and also weather forecasting service in this region. So the India Meteorological Department had organized a workshop in the first week of October to discuss ways to establish a regional climate center in order to provide climate analysis and forecasting services. And this proposed regional center will function under the World Meteorological Organization. We saw that this Hindu Kush Himalayan region is vulnerable to climate change, but the data gathering in this region is sparse, that is quite low, or say there is only scattered data available. So this proposed regional center will facilitate the data sharing between the countries so that there will be improved forecasts and improved predictions. And according to the news article, the World Meteorological Organization has proposed to establish nodal centers in these three countries, that is India, China and Pakistan, and this would provide data services, then training and capacity building and research and development. So this regional climate center will give us more research and more forecasts, and it will also provide information on the hydrological extremes. So this is all about this regional climate center. Let us see about India Meteorological Department. It is the principal agency of the government of India in matters related to meteorology, seismology and related matters like weather forecasting. Meteorology is nothing but the scientific study of the atmosphere that focuses on the weather processes and weather forecasting. And seismology is basically the study of earthquakes and the seismic waves that move through and around the earth. This department was established in the year 1875 when the British ruled India. Now this department is functioning under the Union Ministry of Earth Sciences. The mandate of this department includes the following. One is that it aims to focus the weather and provide information for the optimum operation of the weather sensitive activities like agriculture, irrigation, shipping. So with the help of this data, these activities would be carried out. And this department also aims to warn against the severe weather phenomena like tropical cyclones, dust storms, heavy rains, snow, etc. So that timely availability of data will prevent the destruction of life and property. So basically we can say that it is the principal weather agency of the government of India. And you can regularly see in the news articles whenever there is monsoon or whenever there is a cyclone or whenever there is an earthquake, notifications come from this India Meteorological Department. Now let us see the World Meteorological Organization. It is an intergovernmental organization. Around 193 countries and territories are members of this World Meteorological Organization. This World Meteorological Organization originated from the International Meteorological Organization. It was established by the ratification of the World Meteorological Organization Convention in March 1950. and know that World Meteorological Organization is the specialized agency of the United Nations. So this organization focuses on meteorology, that is the weather and climate which we saw, and also on operational hydrology and related geophysical sciences. Know that the headquarters of World Meteorological Organization is in Geneva. So this is all about this news article and about the two organizations which we saw. Now in the context of this news article, we must also look into one assessment report which was released by the International Center for Integrated Mountain Development. Know that this International Center for Integrated Mountain Development is a regional intergovernmental learning and knowledge sharing center of the Hindu Kush Himalayas. It serves basically the 8 member countries of the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, which are the countries of Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, India, Myanmar, Nepal and Pakistan. And the headquarters of this center is located at Kathmandu, the capital of Nepal. Now, this international center has released a report which is called the Hindu Kush Himalaya Assessment Report. This report has revealed some dangerous facts. Let us see some of them now. One is that it tells that more than 1/3 of the glaciers in this Hindu Kush Himalayan region could retreat. That is, it would melt by the year 2100, even if the global temperature rise is capped at 1.5 degrees Celsius. So this will have a major impact on the snow covering in this region. So when the snow covering is impacted, it will also affect the river flows. And when the river flow is affected, water availability will also be affected in all those countries that are dependent on this Hindu Kush Himalayan region. And the melting of ice will also result in rising sea levels. So this will also threaten the low-lying countries of the world. And this report also said that the changes in the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, that is the climatic changes in the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, will significantly shift the monsoon patterns. So this can either increase the rainfall or it will decrease the rainfall levels. So this will affect the monsoon dependent countries like India. And this report also says that even if the rise in the temperature can be limited to 1.5 degrees Celsius, it will lead to a 2.1 degrees Celsius warming in the Hindu Kush Himalayan region. That is, the average temperature in this region will rise by 2.1 degrees Celsius. This is because of the elevation dependent warming. It is nothing but the phenomenon of enhancing of the warming rate with the increase in the altitude. That is, with the increase in the elevation. So that is why this region is more vulnerable to climate change. And in order to tackle this climate change, the World Meteorological Organization has come up with this regional climate center for Hindu Kush Himalayan region. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This discussion is based on an article on salt intake. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. This news article states that in the Journal of Clinical Hypertension, a statement was published. The statement suggests that the salt which is sold in supermarkets for consumption and the salt dispersers which are used in the restaurants should carry a health warning. And this warning should be in the front of pack. Front of pack is a term which is nothing but a labeling method. Many food and drink products nowadays display nutritional information on the front of the food package. This is called as front of pack nutrition labels. This is basically to provide a simple and a visible summary of the nutritional quality of the product that is being consumed. Then the journal has also suggested that the warning should be in a tobacco style health warning. You may have seen a tobacco health warning on the package of the tobacco products. The warning is given because, according to World Health Organization, globally many people are not fully aware of, or they misunderstand, or they underestimate the risks of tobacco and its smoke. Likewise, this journal is also calling for a health warning for salt as well. The warning label should be clearly visible and easily readable. And the warning should indicate that consumption of excess sodium is a health risk, and it should advise consumers to use less sodium. If you see, in India, the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India does not currently require a reporting of sodium content on pack. However, it has a proposal for making it mandatory to display red color coding on their labels. This is for the food products that are high on fat, sugar and salt content levels. Now, you may be surprised because salt is a staple ingredient in all the food that we eat, and it gives the real taste to the food that we eat. But what is the health risk in consuming excess salt? It is because of the presence of sodium in salt. The main source of sodium in our diet, in the food that we daily take, is salt. And as we all know, that normal table salt is nothing but sodium chloride. So sodium is an essential nutrient in the salt, and this sodium is necessary for the maintenance of plasma volume, then acid-base balance, transmission of nerve impulses, and also for the normal cell function in our body. So sodium ensures normal functioning of our body at cellular level. But if you see, excess sodium is linked to adverse health outcomes. According to World Health Organization, elevated sodium intake or excess sodium intake has been associated with a number of non-communicable diseases like hypertension, cardiovascular disease, stroke, etc. So decreasing the intake of sodium may reduce the blood pressure, and it may also reduce the risk of associated non-communicable diseases. Now, how sodium enters our diet and our body? The primary contributors to dietary sodium consumption depend on the cultural context and the dietary habits of a particular population. The salt in the diet can come from processed foods. This is because of two reasons. One is because processed foods are particularly high in salt, such as you can take the example of ready-to-eat meals, then processed meats like bacon, ham and salami, then cheese, then salty snack foods and instant noodles and such other products. And the second reason is because they are consumed frequently in large amounts. Now, this is because food products such as bread and processed cereal products have high salt content, and we intake these products more than other processed foods. Then salt is also added to food during cooking, that is normal cooking, and they are added at the table in the form of soy sauce, fish sauce, and also table salt. So all these products contain high levels of salt, that is sodium. Then sodium is also contained in sodium glutamate. This sodium glutamate is used as a food additive in many parts of the world. So how to tackle the high blood pressure that is caused because of the intake of excess sodium? It can be tackled by the intake of potassium. Know that potassium is an essential nutrient that is needed for the maintenance of the total body fluid volume, then acid and electrolyte balance, and also for normal cellular function of our body. According to World Health Organization, increased potassium intake will reduce systolic and diastolic blood pressure in adults. See, a person's blood pressure is recorded as two different numbers. One is the systolic blood pressure and the other is the diastolic blood pressure. These two numbers reflect the different aspects of the pressure that is being exerted by your blood as it pulses through your arteries. You would have noticed in the hospitals or in the clinics that while writing blood pressure, it is written as 120/80. Here, 120 denotes the systolic blood pressure and 80 denotes the diastolic blood pressure. So potassium intake will reduce these blood pressure in the adults. And if you see, potassium is commonly found in a variety of unrefined foods, especially in fruits and vegetables. Now you should remember that intake of sodium should not be stopped, but we should not take excess sodium. So how much sodium in excess? For this, the World Health Organization has given certain recommendations on the intake of salt or the consumption of salt. If you see, World Health Organization recommends that adults should consume less than 2 gram of sodium per day. So an individual can take 5 gram of salt per day. This 5 gram of salt has 2 gram of sodium, and 5 gram is just under a teaspoon. Then for children, World Health Organization recommends that the recommended maximum intake of salt for adults shall be adjusted downward for children who are aged between 2 to 15 years. And the amount can be based on the energy requirements of children relative to those of adults. Also, the World Health Organization recommends that all salt that is consumed should be iodized or fortified with iodine. This is essential because for healthy brain development in the fetus and also for the healthy brain development in the young children, and also optimizes people's mental function in general. Now, you should also know that the World Health Organization has established a target for reduction in the sodium intake. This target is based on the Global Action Plan for the Prevention and Control of Non-Communicable Diseases 2013 to 2020 by the World Health Organization. This action plan provides a roadmap and a menu of policy options for all member states and other stakeholders. It calls to take coordinated and coherent action at all levels, that is from the local to global levels. This is basically to attain the 9 voluntary global targets under this action plan. So in this, the target 4 is a 30% relative reduction in mean population intake of salt or sodium. So based on this target, some manufacturers are reformulating their recipes to reduce the salt content of their products. And if you see in the Indian context, our government has also established a target. This target is under the National Multisectoral Action Plan for Prevention and Control of Common Non-Communicable Diseases 2017 to 2022. And know that this action plan is framed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare with other stakeholders. And under this action plan, the government of India has a target to achieve a relative reduction in the mean population intake of salt. So the aim is to achieve the recommended level of less than 5 grams per day. And by the year 2020, the target is to reduce 20% salt intake. And by the year 2030, the target is to reduce 30% of salt intake. So from today onwards, let us educate our family and friends to take less sodium and salt in our diet. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the concerns that have been raised by the Union Minister for Agriculture and Farmers Welfare to the Union Minister for Commerce and Industry before the Union Minister of Commerce and Industry is about to leave India for the ministerial meeting on RCEP. So in this news article, we'll be seeing about RCEP. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. RCEP is nothing but the acronym for Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. This RCEP is a proposed free trade agreement between 10 Asian countries with 6 other countries. The 6 other countries are India, China, Australia, New Zealand, Japan and South Korea. This idea of RCEP was announced by ASEAN, that is the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, in the year 2012. The declaration for RCEP came at the ASEAN summit in the year 2012, and the negotiators met for this free trade agreement for the first time in the year 2013, but know that till now a deal has not been arrived. There are still discussions going on between the ASEAN and the other 6 countries, but until now the deal has not been arrived. But it is expected that this RCEP would be signed in mid of the year 2020. Certain countries like India are not willing to sign this RCEP because they have certain concerns. We have discussed in detail about the concerns of India and certain other nations in our 30th June analysis. Just have a look at it for further clarity. Now let us focus on the news article. This news article speaks about the concerns that have been raised by the Union Minister for Agriculture and Farmers Welfare to the Union Minister of Commerce and Industry because he is going to visit Bangkok for the ministerial meeting on the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership this week. The Union Minister for Agriculture has conveyed that farmers' interest should be India's priority during the negotiations for RCEP. Now, why such a statement has been told by the Union Minister? Because we saw that RCEP is a free trade agreement. Generally, if you see, free trade agreements are signed between 2 or more countries to reduce the trade barriers so that there will be increase in the trade of goods and services. Say, for example, you can take the example of the trade in goods, that is any agricultural goods. Here in our news article, the context is agriculture. Now, if the free trade agreement is signed, it might lead to flooding of agricultural goods from the other countries that are party to this agreement. So it will affect the local agricultural trade. So this is one concern which has been raised by the Union Minister of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. And there are many other concerns of India that have been raised during various negotiations on RCEP. And we have discussed in detail on 30th June analysis as already told. Just have a look at it for further clarity. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Now see the question. Consider the following statements. They have given 2 statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. The first statement tells that e-assessment scheme of Income Tax Department aims at faceless assessment of income tax returns. This statement is correct. Know that Income Tax Department comes under the Ministry of Finance. And during our discussion, we saw that e-assessment scheme is being implemented by the Ministry of Finance. So the first statement is correct. Now see the second statement. It tells that the National E-Assessment Center and Regional E-Assessment Centers, as per the scheme, will have all India jurisdiction. This statement is also correct. We saw that there will be a National E-Assessment Center at Delhi and 8 regional E-Assessment Centers. And based on the notification of the Ministry of Finance, these regional E-Assessment Centers will have all India jurisdiction. So the second statement is also correct. This question has asked you to choose the correct statements. The correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Now see the second question. The question is, consider the following statements regarding Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey. Two statements have been given and you are asked to choose the correct statements. See the first statement. It tells that the objective of the survey is to measure only malnutrition in rural and urban children. During our discussion, we saw that the survey aims to measure the malnutrition and also to measure anthropometric data such as weight for age, height for age, weight for height, etc. And it will also focus on details of non-communicable diseases like diabetes, hypertension, cholesterol and kidney function in children and adolescents. And also regarding the prevalence of obesity or overweight, then muscular strength and fitness. So it is not just only for the malnutrition, but also for the other parameters that we saw. So the first statement goes wrong. Now see the second statement. It tells that the survey is released jointly by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and UNICEF. This statement is correct. We saw that this Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey was conducted between 2016 and 18 by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and United Nations Children's Fund, which is in short UNICEF. Now this question is asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option B, 2 only, since the first statement is wrong. Now see the next question. This question is for your understanding of the topic. The question is, consider the following statements regarding the Hindu Kush Himalayan region. They have given two statements and you have to choose the correct statements. The first statement, it tells that a regional climate center for the Hindu Kush Himalayan region is proposed between India, China and Myanmar. This statement is wrong. During our discussion, we saw that a regional climate center is proposed between India, China and Pakistan. It's not Myanmar. Now see the second statement, it tells that the proposed regional climate center will function under the aegis of International Center for Integrated Mountain Development. This statement is also wrong. During our discussion, we saw that the proposed regional center will be under the World Meteorological Organization, not the International Center for Integrated Mountain Development. Now this question has asked you to choose the correct statements. The correct answer is option D, neither 1 nor 2, since both the statements are wrong. Now see the next question. Consider the following statements. They have given two statements again and they have asked you to choose the correct statement. The first statement, it tells that World Health Organization recommend adults should consume less than 5 gram of sodium per day. This statement is wrong. Read the sentence carefully, because World Health Organization recommend adults should consume less than 5 gram of salt per day, not 5 gram of sodium. The correct amount of sodium recommended by the World Health Organization is 2 gram. So the 5 gram of salt has 2 gram of sodium and 5 gram is just under a teaspoon. But in the question is given as 5 gram of sodium. So the first statement is wrong. Now see the second statement. It tells that India has a target to achieve a relative 20% and 30% reduction in mean population intake of salt by the year 2020 and 30 respectively. This statement is also correct. India has a target to achieve a relative reduction in mean population intake of salt with an aim of achieving recommended level of less than 5 grams per day. And by the year 2020, the target is to reduce 20% salt intake. And by the year 2030, the target is to reduce 30% of salt intake. Also remember, this target is under the National Multisectoral Action Plan for Prevention and Control of Common Non-Communicable Diseases 2017-2022 of the Government of India. Now this question is asked to choose the correct statements. The correct answer is option B, 2 only, since the first statement is wrong. Now look at the mains question. The question is, what is zero budget natural farming? How far it is helpful in sustaining agricultural production? So first explain what is meant by zero budget natural farming. Then you have to mention the aims of this method of farming. Then also list the four pillars of zero budget natural farming that we saw. Now see the second part of the question. It tells that how far it is helpful in sustaining agricultural production. For this, you have to mention how this method is helping in agricultural production and how it is also not helping in agricultural production. So first, a list of the advantages That is the positive impacts of zero budget natural farming. Like you can say, this method does not use chemical fertilizer, so the damage to the environment is less. Then you can say that all the important formulations such as Jeevamritam, Bijamritam, etc. can be prepared by the farmers themselves, and they need not spend money to buy chemical fertilizer, and they need not have any expertise to prepare the formulations. Then you can also say that this method is a form of low external input sustainable agriculture, which we saw during our discussion. It is because all the inputs are to be locally resourced from in and around the village, or it can be resourced even within the farm in a symbiotic way. Then we also saw that zero budget natural farming also includes three methods of insect and pest management, which are Agniastra, Brahmastra and Neemastra, and they depend on the nature and type of insect or pest attack. And for different attack, different formulations from locally available resources are prepared. We saw some different preparations using cow urine, cow dung, tobacco, fruits, green chili, garlic and neem during our discussion. So all these preparations work as biopesticides so that the farmers need not spend on other chemical fertilizers. So with the help of natural methods, the farmers can attain agricultural productivity. So these are some of the advantages. Then you can also list the disadvantages of this method, which we saw during our discussion, like actually it is not zero budget because farmers have to spend money on certain inputs. Like this, we also saw certain other disadvantages of zero budget natural farming. Finally, you can conclude the answer by saying that inclusion of zero budget natural farming method in our agricultural policy is a welcome step, but promoting it as a sole alternative to the existing agricultural practices may not be sustainable. So this is how we can end this answer. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.